Wow. Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and good morning. My name is Greg, and I am one of the pastors here at First Presbyterian Church, and it is my joy to welcome you to worship, those of you joining us here in the sanctuary and those of you joining us wherever you may be, whether it be in a truck or whether it may be on your living room floor or maybe it is in your kitchen. Wherever you may be, we appreciate that you have joined us this morning. A few announcements this morning. One, I wish I had one of my shakers that we had last week saying amen to that beautiful prelude duet from our pianist Lynn Dulac and our organist Joanne McNamara. That was fantastic and a wonderful way to start the worship this morning. Also, reminder that this week, today, started our first, and we'll continue to do this, adult Sunday school class that meets downstairs in the fellowship hall at 9:15. So we'll meet. We have an interesting conversation. It's called The Ridiculous Journey, about why someone might want to follow this man named Jesus that we follow and we preach and talk about and worship every day and every Sunday. So we invite you to come to that. Starting this afternoon at 4 o'clock, for all our families, we are doing we're restarting hiking and donuts. We'll be at the Billings Tomfor Conservation Area. We'll park at the teacher's parking lot at Twin Bluff Middle School and go up the hill from there. And there will be some conversation and some hiking and, most importantly, some Dunkin' Donuts Munchkins. For all those that want to come and participate. We look forward to that this afternoon. And that we'll be doing that every Sunday at 4 o'clock. Check our website and our happenings for the locations every week. And also, today we're doing something very different. In this year of things that are different, we have a guest preacher today. But through the miracle of technology, that guest preacher will be joining us from Atlanta, Georgia. Dr. Raj Nadella is the Samuel A. Cartledge Associate Professor of New Testament at Columbia Theological Seminary in Decatur, Georgia. He is a seminary colleague of both Heidi and I. Heidi has more stories than I do about Raj because, or Dr. Nadella, as he is, I know him as Raj, through our She lived in the same building as he did, and he and I watched TV together at the community room in our dorm in seminary. So I look forward to hearing from Raj today, a great word. And I think that ends our announcements for this morning. I would like for us to take a deep breath. And for those in the building, I would invite you to rise in body or spirit and join me quietly in the call to worship, which will be on the screen. We worship in the Easter light, for the shadow of death is no match for God's love. Let us join our voices with the disciple Thomas, my Lord and my God. Easter people, Christ is risen. Christ is risen again. Let us pray. Ever and always present, Holy One, you companion us every moment of every day. In the pre-dawn darkness, in the evening dusk, in life and in death, joy and sorrow, in abundance and emptiness, in safety and in fear. But finite and earthbound, we confess, we human creatures don't always sense your eternal presence. Forgive us, author of life. Sharpen our awareness of you always in our midst. Breathe light and life into the dead, empty places of our lives. Infuse us with your spirit. Wash us with your word. Speak peace to each weary soul. Open our eyes, our minds, our hearts to receive gifts and grace. And having forgiven us, help us forgive ourselves. Friends, who is in a position to condemn? Only Christ. And Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. Christ prays for us. Know that you are forgiven. and be at peace. Amen. You may be seated. Now I invite, now we will get an opportunity to hear and sing, or maybe mouth, or just think the words to Thine is the Glory, as presented by Joanne and McNamara, our organist, and Scott Perro, our choir director. Time I hear that song, I just sort of like, I want to like pump my fist, and because I think if you're out there and you want to do something that would help the church, I would invite you to get a metal guitar riff for that song, an arrangement with drums and bass, you know, the whole bit. So as I said earlier, we are joined today in worship by Dr. Raj Nadella from Columbia Theological Seminary. Raj is a fantastic theologian, a fantastic New Testament scholar, and he taught Pastor Heidi Greek, and he taught me many things standing in front of the TV watching The Daily Show most nights in seminary. So with that, I invite you to to hear the Word of God in a new way from Dr. Raj Nadella.
Hello, everybody. Greetings from Atlanta. My name is Raj Nadella, and I serve as the Samuel A. Cartledge Associate Professor of New Testament at Columbia Theological Seminary. It is my pleasure and honor to share God's word with you today. The scripture text for today is taken from John chapter 20, verses from 19 to 29. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." This is the word of the Lord. The gospel text reads like a scene out of a fascinating movie. The disciples had lost their Savior and are now locked up in a room to avoid trouble. Jesus walks through closed doors and makes a surprise appearance to the disciples. He shows them his hands and side, apparently to convince them that he had risen from the dead. There was much celebration. Thomas missed this joyful reunion as he was away taking a long walk, perhaps. When the other disciples told him about seeing the risen Lord, Thomas made it clear that he did not believe them. The Greek word elegon suggests that the disciples kept telling him that they saw Jesus. But Thomas wasn't ready to believe it. He wanted proof that the Jesus who appeared to the disciples was the same Jesus who was crucified. He wanted concrete proof of the risen Jesus. It must have been hard for Thomas and other disciples to believe that Jesus, who confronted the Roman Empire and challenged its status quo, could actually survive and tell the story. It would have been hard to fathom that anyone could beat Rome's death machine and live again. Jesus was not the first to be crucified by the Roman Empire, which had effectively eliminated every single challenge to its apparatus of oppression. And so, understandably, the idea of meeting risen Jesus seemed unrealistic to Thomas. For communities ravaged by imperial violence, the idea that justice can prevail seems like an impossible scenario. But John's gospel is telling us that Thomas was not interested solely in learning that Jesus rose from the dead. If Thomas only wanted proof that Jesus had risen, he would have simply asked to see Jesus and perhaps touch him. But Thomas was asking for much more. He says, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." Why is it especially important for Thomas to see Jesus' nail marks? Why is it important for him to feel the holes left by the nails and touch the wound in his side that has been pierced by the Romans? Apparently, Thomas isn't simply asking for proof of Jesus' resurrection. He wants proof of his crucifixion and suffering as well. He seems much more interested in making sure that the Jesus who appeared to the disciples was in fact crucified. And he wants visible and tangible manifestation of Jesus' suffering. Later, when Jesus makes another appearance, he invites Thomas to examine for himself his nail marks and his side. All this begs the question, why was it important for Thomas to be convinced that Jesus did in fact die on the cross and suffer? Gerard Sloan has helpfully noted that John's gospel was confronted with an early form of docetism when the gospel was written. Docetics doubted Jesus' crucifixion and death. They believed that Jesus was a phantom-like figure who appeared to suffer on the cross, but did not actually suffer or die on the cross. Within that context, John likely employed the Thomas figure to address such doubts and highlight the significance of Jesus' suffering and death on the cross, which explains the emphasis on the nails and putting his hand in the side that was pierced. On a practical level, Thomas and others like him must have known at least a few false prophets who led popular movements against the Roman Empire, gave powerful speeches about confronting oppressive structures, built an image as champions of justice, but quietly slipped away when they had to put their bodies on the line. Which is why Thomas wants visible and tangible proof of Jesus putting his body on the line in the process of confronting the empire. He is insisting on proof that Jesus wasn't just an eloquent preacher and a charismatic leader, but actually had his skin in the game, nails in his flesh, and a spear in his side. When Jesus finally met Thomas, he invited him to touch his wounds. We don't know if Thomas actually touched Jesus' wounds. He likely did not. He did not need to. The scars left by the wounds were too big to miss and too scary to touch. Instead, Thomas responds by saying, "My God and my Lord." What made Jesus God and Lord was not his power, but his wounds and scars. It is not the resurrection alone that brings Thomas joy in this story, but the assurance that Jesus did in fact die on the cross. For Thomas, The scars of Jesus represent Christ's commitment to suffer along with the marginalized, to confront the power of the empire and stand in solidarity with the powerless. The scars of Jesus reflect his willingness to place his own body on the line alongside the marginalized who were dehumanized by the empire. The story of Thomas highlights embodied solidarity that was quintessential to the story of Jesus. God who became flesh and dwelt among us. God who suffered in the process of confronting forces of evil. Incarnation was about Word becoming flesh and the flesh putting itself on the line alongside the oppressed. The Word became flesh and allowed itself to be pierced and scarred. In his book, The Cross and the Lynching Tree, James Cone observed powerfully that, and I quote, "The gospel of Jesus is not a rational concept to be explained in a theory of salvation, but a story about God's presence in Jesus' solidarity with the oppressed, which led to his death on the cross," end quote. Cone goes on to add, "What is redemptive is the faith that God snatches victory out of defeat, life out of death, and hope out of despair," end quote. The hope that James Cone highlights can only be realized in our context when God's people stand in solidarity with each other to challenge forces of oppression. As we continue to reflect on Easter, meeting the risen Lord should not be solely or even primarily about celebrating his victory over death. Instead, it should be about recalling his wounds, which are a visible and tangible reminder that God stands in solidarity alongside us. They're also an invitation for us to be in solidarity with each other and place our own bodies on the line for those at the margins. The scars of Jesus tell us that the forces of death that sought to end his life will not have the final word. That there is hope for the oppressed who are often demoralized when evil seems to be winning on a regular basis. The story of Thomas and the Gospel of John in general tell us that embodiment matters in the struggle against injustice. The story of Thomas and the Gospel of John invite us to not substitute words and prayers for actions in the process of challenging the powers of our time. At a time when many Christians these days are letting thoughts and prayers take the place of embodied solidarity, the story of Thomas challenges us to have our skin in the game and be invested in the work of transforming structures of power, whatever the cost might be. Amen.
Thank you for Dr. Nadella for joining us in worship today. Thank you for listening in a new way to the proclamation of the gospel. And as we enter this space of prayer for our community and for our world, we offer continued prayers for the jury and the lawyers and the judge and all those who are in part of the administration of the Derek Chauvin trial ongoing in Minneapolis at the Hennepin County Courthouse. We offer prayers for those that gather at the Hennepin County Courthouse every day to listen, to protest, to raise their voice so that they may feel heard. We pray for our own community with conversations around race and struggle and economic disadvantagement. And we continue to pray for our indigenous folks whose land that we sit on. And we also pray for all of those who are continuing to suffer from the virus known as COVID-19. Let us pray. Risen Christ, our eternal Savior, like the disciples, we are gathered together the week after Easter, wondering whether it's true, marveling at the possibility and daring to hope. Like the disciples, we are sometimes afraid, sometimes full of doubt, but in your extravagant generosity, your boundless love, you appear to us in our fear and love us in our doubts, and grant us the oceans of your peace. Thank you for loving us as we are. Teach us not to hide from our doubt, but to recognize it as a door to mystery and to a deeper faith. After all, the disciples' fear became a visitation, and as they saw you among them risen and triumphant, Thomas's doubt became a moment of revelation, as he saw and touched you and finally believed. This morning we pray for the men and women, the people in our society who have no faith at all. There are so many who live without hope, without knowledge of your resurrection, without your light in their lives. Grant us the courage to live as witnesses to your resurrection. Risen Christ, be light in our world. We pray for those in our congregation this morning who find it difficult to believe. Lord knows that they are not alone, but in the best of company. Even Christ's own disciples struggled to believe all that they had seen and heard. Loving Christ, it is your presence that removes all fear and erases all doubts. So come and grant the doubting Thomases in our midst your presence and peace. And grant us all, to all of us living Lord Jesus, renewed faith, great courage, and your boundless peace. Let us pray as you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This morning we will be blessed with a song called Climbing Up the Mountain from Lynn Dulac and Scott Perrow.
Children, pass my way. I'm gonna keep on climbing up the mountain till I make it on home. I'm gonna keep on climbing up the mountain till I make it on home. I'm gonna keep on climbing up the mountain till I make it on home.
Friends, we are like Thomas at times. Raj actually taught me that the Greek in that scripture says that Jesus entered and some worshiped and some doubted. So you can do that at the same time. You can worship and you can doubt. And you can embody the solidarity that with those who are in pain, who are hurting, who are crying out for the balm of Christ. So I challenge you, I encourage you to embody the solidarity with those whose stories you may not have heard before, or whose stories sound untrue to you, or whose stories do not fit with your experience. I challenge you to hear their stories, to embody their stories, and to be in solidarity with them as they act. Whether that's adding food to the food pantry, whether that's giving money to a BIPOC-led organization, whether that's marching on the Capitol, or maybe a different place, not the Capitol. Maybe that's standing with a sign outside your house. Maybe that's putting up a flag. There are all kinds of ways for you to be in solidarity with those who are hurting. Sometimes it's a phone call. Sometimes it's a hug. Sometimes it's a Facebook post. But know that whatever you do, remember that every single day God looks down upon each and every one of us and says, "Beloved, with you I am well pleased." Know that in here. Feel that in here and live that where you are. In your homes, in your workplaces, in your schools, in your fields, wherever you are, remember that you are loved and God loves all God's creation, everyone called beloved. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and forever. Amen.